good evening and welcome. Welcome to the New School. My name is Karen Coney. I'm the director of the Vera List Center for Art and Politics and collaborating with the Public Art Fund for a number of years now on this extraordinary lecture series. In New York, I think we have no shortage of outstanding provocative sculpture in public place, thanks to the Public Art Fund and a few other organizations. But it is rare to have a master of Katharina Grosse's profile here and have her here in person, who gives us work that eludes all customary definition. She produces sculpture that has all the hallmarks of paintings and yet challenges long-standing assumptions about it, such as the expressiveness of the painter's brushstroke that is, in her case, performed or executed often by stand-ins. There's also a sly sense of humor that has no reference to storyline. There's site specificity seemingly without content and abstraction deeply imprinted by the human body, often her own. We're honored to have Katharina Grosse here. I'd like to acknowledge our long-standing partnership with the Public Art Fund, and in particular, I'd like to thank Andrea Hickey, the fund's associate curator, who has been working with us for a number of years and is also the person now to introduce Katharina. Thank you all very much for coming.
Thank you, Karen, and thanks everyone here at the Vera List and the New School for your help in organizing this series. This is the second talk of our spring series, which is entitled Encounters, Artists, Cities, and Communities. And each season we bring together a group of artists around a theme. And this theme, we're working with artists who have each engaged with different ways of working with urban spaces and their communities. And of course, Katharina Grosse is one of the artists we're working with this year. We do have another talk coming up on May 20th with Elm Green and Drag Set, so please be sure to come back and get your tickets soon because we expect it'll be a full house. So I'm very, very excited to introduce Katharina to the stage here tonight. I had the pleasure of working with her this past fall on her large-scale sculptural installation at Metrotech Center in downtown Brooklyn, which is actually up until mid-July. So if you haven't had a chance to see it, I really recommend checking it out. But for those of you who haven't yet been there, it's basically a very large sculpture that is made of 18 individual pieces that have been installed within a kind of grove of trees in Metrotech. And if you can kind of imagine giant pieces of firewood being dropped down on a grove of trees, that might give you a picture. And Katharina, I'm sure, will show images. But as Karen mentioned, Katharina works very differently than your traditional painter. And her works are often painted using a large scale or large nozzle spray gun, which means that she's actually, when you're watching her make her work, wearing full protective gear and spraying this giant gun so that the paint of the surface of the object is very diaphanous and layered in multiple colors and really creates a very vivid surface on each plane of an object. So I think her thoughts on painting and the contributions she's made in the field have been tremendous, and it is quite exciting to be able to hear more about her work. One of the things she mentioned to me when we were working together is that she really thought about her sculptural installations as if it was a piece of canvas that had been put under a microscope. So if you can imagine the grooves of the actual material being painted, which I think is a really beautiful way to think about sculpture and painting in general. And I'm often at the Public Art Fund not in conversation with artists about painting. So it's incredibly exciting to be here tonight and talk about what it means to actually think about painting in the public realm. So, just a little bit of your traditional details about Katharina. She's had quite an extensive career over the past 20 years and has been the subject of many solo museum exhibitions, including the Nasher Sculpture Center, Mass MoCA, the Contemporary Art Museum in Cleveland, and the Arken Museum of Modern Art in Denmark. She has been commissioned by institutions across the globe, including DePel in Amsterdam, the Palais de Tokyo in Paris, the Shinadi Foundation in Texas, and the Hammer Museum in Los Angeles. She lives in Berlin and has been a teacher at the Kunstakademie in Dusseldorf for quite a long time, I think. And her work is represented by Johann Koenig Gallery in Berlin. Please join me in welcoming Katharina to the stage.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming tonight, and thank you so much for having me here and for introducing me so nicely to everybody. I'm very happy to be in this beautiful space with you tonight. I just realized it's like an egg. So we're going to spend the next 60 minutes maybe, hopefully together in these special circumstances, and let's see how we get out here again. I'm a painter, as has been said, and I'm very happy to be able to talk to you now and tell you everything I know. Or everything you maybe need to know about painting. And for me, it started with, sometimes you have these encounters that are really special to you and they stay with you during all your processes. And one of them was for me to see what Edvard Munch did. You know Edvard Munch, the very amazing painter from Norway, who spent a little bit of time in Paris, came back to Norway, and totally found a new way to paint for himself, and that had a big influence on me. And I found these photographs early on that showed how he was actually doing his work, and he was working outside a lot. So he created these special studios that were outdoor studios. So they were half-finished spaces sometimes, and he would have his paintings all side by side, work on many paintings at the same time, something that I did very early on as well, that I loved. And he had this idea that the painting has to be confronted with another environment, with the nature, for example. And he would leave the paintings outside under snow, in rain, in the dry sunshine, and he thought that his paintings would change. And that change would be essential for what they were supposed to be after a little while. So he would hand over his work to a situation. And here we see him with a big painting that is called The Sun. It's hanging on a hook. It's taken off the canvas. And somehow that inspired me. And I was thinking maybe a painting should behave differently than just sit on a wall. At the beginning, I was very conscious of the wall and the size of the walls, and I was thinking that my paintings should react in size to the given size of the walls the galleries were being made of. And after a little while, I thought, maybe that is too sculptural. Maybe I'm too much using the space as a measured given. And I realized that painted space is a very different space. It can't be measured. So why would I confine the ideas of measured space, of unmeasured space to measured space, like three-dimensional architectural setups. So I started to long for a different way to behave myself as a painter in a spatial setup. And I did my first spray painting in 98 in a gallery in Bern, where the curator said, you can do whatever you like. And I walked into the space, and I kind of glanced around, and my eyes would hit up the corner, and I was thinking that would be maybe great to have a painting up there, something that is not exactly sitting within the confined wall size. And I did this first spray painting with a spray gun, industrial. I used a color that was, it's called phthalo green, so it has an amazing way to change from deep, dark, nearly black, to when it's a little less opaque, it is a little bit like bottle green, even like a very translucent, beautiful tree green. So to me, it was actually like a multi-colored painting that was kind of slipping up a little bit the wall into the ceiling. And sitting in the corner that has already like a sculptural situation that would also give you the impression that there is something sitting in between the walls. So there's not only that imprint of something on the wall, but maybe also the reflections of the different colors collecting like a colored space between the walls. I was very fascinated by this phenomenon. I didn't think I would see it. I didn't think about it when I made the work, but then as I looked at the work when it was finished, it gave me a lot of ideas for the next step. And the next step for me was to understand what it actually means to have a painted illusionistic space sitting on a built space, because that is actually like two systems colliding and coinciding that normally exclude one another. So it's like a paradox. You're confronted with a paradox. And I was as well, as I was working. While I was working, I was thinking in an illusionistic spatial world, but I was kind of having it sit on something that could be measured, that could be named, like three vectors building the architectural Euclidean space. And I started to be very fascinated by actually confronting painting with a paradox, with the ability to have different characteristics coincide. And I think that is so essential to painting. And you will see that in all the paintings all over the world during the last 20,000 years, the ability of a painting to show future, present, and past coincide. And that is something that I started to understand for myself, that is the reason why I paint, because it makes you see the things you did first and the things you did later and the things you have just done to finish the work at the same time. And that is something that no other medium can really do. And that is one of the reasons why I'm so interested in making that work. I went on, of course, to do other things. I started to use different colors. I started to decide which colors to use according to the spaces I was in. And as you can see here, I'm not dealing with a wall that's kind of flat and clean, but I have different surfaces like corrugated iron and also different directions within the space. So you would come in to the space, for example, and then you wouldn't see the whole painting. And as you would turn around, all of a sudden you would see how it would develop. So I was very fascinated by this possibility of using the space to make you the center of the work. So you would drift as the center and would then see from bit to bit what the work would actually be like. There was no one real right point of view from which you could see the work. So the relationship here, you see very clearly, is not anymore the painting and the wall, but it's more the painting and the surface of the inside of a body. That was starting to be really fascinating to me, that there was actually the surface and the volume would make up a container for the piece. And as I went on, Andrea has pointed at it, I went to Marfa and I had the studio, which is called the Locker Plant, which has this old shop, and in the back there are studio spaces. So I was painting a little bit like a wall painting, and during the day I would go to the studio and do other works. And I had no idea what this would look like from the outside, because when I went home, I switched off the lights. So one time some friends came by and took me for a beer, and they said, hey, this looks really good. And that's when I understood that there is an outside to the work, and that the work has a relationship to the building from the outside as well. So I started to see something that I did not see so clearly with my studio work. And that is something I needed to say to you maybe earlier on. My practice is very diverse and hybrid, so I also work in the studio all the time and make canvas paintings. So this is not a decision of this or that, but I'm kind of trying to find out how a painting could actually come about in our contemporary society, and whether it is necessary that it sits out in the open, or whether I do it inside, or whether it should maybe behave differently. So all sorts of different surfaces have started to be really, really important to my work. Even though tonight I will only focus a little more, I will focus on my so-called installational work.
So as you see from the outside into the building, there were also moments when it was just the other way around. I started to use not only surfaces that were walls, but also maybe sometimes bookshelves, or when I started to think, how does actually the color and the paint change and transform the surface? Does it transform the meaning, the function of the different surfaces? So a glass window, for example, that has a very strong photographic impact on our way to look at the world, then coincides in this case with a bookshelf and an architectural little niche in a space. Sometimes the buildings were quite big, so I was starting to not only have experiences with different surfaces, but also scales. So scales started to be a really, really important experience for me in relationship, the relationship of the painting and the buildings, and then my size in relationship to where I was with the painting. So from here, for example, we see, some of you might know it, it's the Niemeyer ramp in the Biennale building in Sao Paulo, where I did a big work for the Biennale. So when you're coming from up, you would see something that looked like a little scribble of a gigantic person. And when you were very close down, you would see it was actually quite a high ceiling and a huge painting. And the painting had a door through which you could go. I think it was the toilets in this case. And I started to be worried. The sizes were getting larger, and that was a big thing. The expansiveness of the wall paintings was kind of limitless, and that was also something that I started to be really, really invested in, that the studio painting was more compression, was I could go back to the canvases, I could overlayer them very often, there was no time frame, whereas with the installations, I would have like 5 days. That was like a material. Time started to be a material like paint and color, and my facilities were, and the spray gun is. So I was thinking about maybe how about I try to look at my work in a more intimate way and make a very small piece in my own environment, maybe in my house. And I was also I was very aggressive. At a moment, I didn't like the whole organizational, logistics of big works anymore, and I was thinking maybe I should spray and paint over my office. That would have maybe a real impact on my work, destroy the organization a little. And then I thought maybe that's too damaging my archive and all these things. So I decided, okay, maybe more intimate, and I went to spray my bedroom. And that was a very important moment because at that time it wasn't as maybe disastrous as you might think. I had two apartments at the time. I was living in Berlin and in Düsseldorf, and I decided to paint over the bedroom in Düsseldorf the way I had left it. And I was wanting to know whether it would have an impact on me in terms of would I feel like loss, would I feel like destruction, how would I actually react to this narrative that the bedroom and the bed and the private, maybe erotic place sort of provides for my painting? Because until then, I've been very, very, very much taking care of excluding all these narrative elements. And to my big surprise, I discovered a lot of amazing things. I opened up my work far more, and I discovered that the color is breaking down the hierarchy of the objects, which you can see here. So the wall goes into the bed, it goes over the duvet on the floor, or here you see the wall over clothes and cushions, and also a lot of other items were painted over, like books and money and CDs, or things I just had around me. And I think that is such an interesting moment of the bed being horizontal. That's a space where you don't really, where you're not really very in transition, in a sense. You're connected to a totally different spatial relationship. You're not with your feet on the ground. You're not part of the three-dimensional architectural rules. And I started to use these experiences in the next paintings and big installations I did for museums. I also realized that the color turns the volume of the objects around. It kind of gives it a glow or a certain look that questions the being of it, that kind of transformed its materialistic functional characteristics and qualities. And so I started to use things in installations on a big scale again. One of the first things after that first experiment with the bedroom was this show in Denmark in Brands Kladefabrik, which is a great institution, one of the first European industrial spaces to be a museum. And they had just built a new wing and they gave that to me to do that show. And it was a little tricky. It was a new oak floor put in, and they were really afraid I would. I painted the floor, as you can see, but so what we did, we put another oak floor on top, so they could take the painted oak floor out and then have their pristine new oak floor. So this painting was called the double floor painting because it addresses something as well that I was not consciously doing, but then I realized I did, that as soon as you walk on that painting, you're very, very unclear about whether you're on a painting or on a floor. You know what I mean? You're on a space that is unfathomable and unmeasurable and imaginative, or whether you're actually on a floor, which is like a functional, very clear condition of being in a space. It's a very large space. As you can see, there's a bookshelf. The bookshelf would also indicate elements of a domestic space. So I kind of overlayered museum public space with domestic space. And the bookshelf has a size of about like 40 feet length and about 15 feet height. And I also incorporated into this piece two very large paintings that I brought from the studio, as you can see here. These were like 18 feet high and 6 feet wide, and they were finished. So I also thought, okay, I have to make my own finished work part of this, painting it over again and see what then happens. Here you see the bookshelf again, and this kind of movement from painted space to unpainted space, from maybe the imaginative, the inner space to the outer materialized space, that has always been something I've been very interested in. Here you see, for example, a little shot of a show I did for Johann König in Berlin, where you had a very abrupt, clear cut where you would be going through different phases of your relationship to the space, a person just venturing through. Yeah, again, a painting from the show in Brands Kleidefabrik, which I then took out and sometimes would also show without the context. That was also a really interesting experiment, so I used the painting sometimes again and again and again, and they would, in different installations, collect information from the things that I had painted then. So here in this case, it was shown in the Albright Knox in Buffalo a couple of years later, as just like a broken little part taken out of another context. And I was thinking that maybe that's the only way to make paintings anymore, because our world is not logic. It is not showing us everything at the same time. We can't argue anymore, like maybe we tried to do in the 19th century, that there is one perspective and one canon and one right opinion. The hierarchies constantly change, and the context as well. So I was thinking maybe we have to think of a painting or as something that is a broken, unfinished, open system that can kind of dock on any other situation, any moment. So I was starting to actually use the work as a constant process also while making it. So in this case, for example, I did, I took a big studio painting, as you can see it here. It was standing here, leaning against the wall. I had brought a lot of soil in. That was a new item that I really loved. I wanted to pop up the painting against the wall, not hanging it on the wall. Then I would paint the whole show, take the whole thing, also the soil. I would take the painting up, put it against the wall on the left-hand side, and insert a new painting into the negative space. So there was not only the painting doing the thing in the while installing, but also shuffling around the elements and gaining different states and stages of the making of the work. and all these different stages would then at the end be on the same time level. That's what I thought was so super fascinating. The painting is quite big. It's like 24 feet high and 12 feet wide, just to give you a dimension. And you could see it from above, where you had like the impression of the soil being something maybe floating on the white, but you could see it also from down and have a totally different relationship scale-wise to the painting and the walls. Okay, and then, of course, the soil got me into situations where I thought maybe I could do this also outside and maybe risk to have something being painted on grass or bushes where maybe something would grow and then the painting would disappear in different stages. So I had a chance of painting in the lower Ninth Ward in the New Orleans Biennale, some of whom you might have seen it. I had the chance of painting one of the houses that were left after that dramatic catastrophe. Here you see the relationship of grass that's not painted and the grass that's painted and the dramatic change of reality perception that you have there. And very often these experiences would then make me do something indoors, you know, that would kind of turn the whole relationship of light and the real of the nature around. So this constant possibility of reversing your situations, whether it's inside or outside, private or public, or low or high in hierarchy, these things I'm really interested in, and that's what I'm trying to find out, how far we can go and how much it influences me in my experience or the people who see it in their experience. This is the Masmoka show that Andrea earlier on mentioned, where I had the huge building that was actually in its quality something like an indoor-outdoor space. As you can see, there are these two stories of windows where the light comes in an enormous power at some point of the day, and I was wanting to give that light some sort of crystallized echo, like a crystallized resonance, and that's why I cut those huge styrofoam charts that were then sitting on some built soil structure. The charts are quite large. They're about 20 feet long and thick. And we cut them there with a hot wire and started building piece by piece the whole show. And in the end, I would paint parts of the soil, and you would actually move through, like through a park, and also move through it and then come up on, as you can see here on the mezzanine, and see the whole thing from above and see actually also where you came from, which is very rare in museums, or it's more like a nature experience that you start somewhere, go someplace, and then you see where you were and you have a feeling of distance and life that has passed, and also an experience of size. I included in that show not only these large sculptural elements, but also soil and a painting, and I also used something like a shape that's bent, that's kind of a snippet that's been cut off from something and was sitting in there. So it was quite a hybrid show that I did there, and that was the first time that I was able to include all the different elements of my painting and my research in it. There was also a little bench you could sit on and have a look at the work. There were predecessors to the soil works as well. Here we have an example of a show in De Appel, where I was really concerned of how could I show paintings in relationship to the soil, and why is the soil, the floor of the building always so flat and clean, and I thought it was super interesting to kind of have this unsettling relationship of dirt and the work, and where does it end and where does it go, and where are you in relationship to be with it. And I was actually giving a talk not so long ago in a conference about the unfinished system, and there were different people talking, and there was one person especially one person who was doing research about spook and haunting, and he was, because that also seems to be a very open system, and he invited me to learn more about what he does, because he said, look, your work looks exactly like the work that I'm dealing with that people send me. I get these photos sent, you know, and they sent me these photos and they say, I haven't done it, I came home and it looked like this. And I was really, really starting to be intrigued, and we did a little interview, and he said to me, the relationship to our environment is much more intensive than we think. It is much less casual. And he started to explain it a little more to me. He said, the relationship of the environment and us is more like as if we are creating a joint theater production with a focus person. And a focus person seems to be somebody who is very dissociative. It's somebody who says, I have not done it. It's come through me. And these are people that tend to externalize things, and that's exactly what artists do. So I started to be more inquisitive, and he said, artists or people that are focused people that are actually attracting spook in their house, they don't accept authorship. Yeah, they divert attention from themselves into the environment. And a ghost, actually, he says, a ghost is somebody who needs audience, and the focus person is like the audience for the ghost. And so I was starting to wonder whether I'm maybe a focus person that is happening to do that work, and what relationship would actually have the audience with my work then? Do they do something with it? I mean, there is no logic to spook, apparently. Spook always happens in different ways, and there is no narrative to spook. You can't really say, I mean, very often people would say, and the knife flew across the room, and the next day there was no knife, but it was something different. So there, I was wondering whether I could be more perceptive to being a ghost. And I set up a soil painting, for example, in the Nasher, in the lower area of the building, which has no daylight. And I allowed the people to really walk in it, to really use it, to be looking at it as if it was like a normal show. And after a little while, it looked like this. And I thought that was fascinating, that all of a sudden, through the people and their use of scale, a totally different appearance of the work could happen, and something disappears, and other pieces stay visible. And the invisible and incomplete, or visible and complete, I was starting to see more as something that's sitting in one another's container. So the invisible is really an inherent quality of the visible. So the uncompleted work, the snippet, the broken off piece that is like an open structure became far more important to me. And I was trying to actually then reverse it again and see a large surface that's not a mass, but just a warped surface as a door into a totally different world, appearing at the same time that it is like confronted with the materialized. In this case, it's a museum wall. Here you see a little bit the space and the relationship with the human size. It's been quite a big piece at the museum in Bonn, and the diameter is about 36 feet, I think. And when you paint it, of course, I didn't paint it there, I painted it in the studio. And once it is up, you start to realize that it is going on. It is going out of the surface. It is actually going into, let's say, a situation here, but there is no painting to be seen. And you can't really say how the painting is going on. There is no logic that kind of tells you this is how it was meant to actually then connect with the far bigger painting structure. And I thought maybe if that is if that is how life is, if that is how I see the world, um, maybe my relationship with people and with social groups is also going to be very different, and has to be very different, has to develop totally different, maybe conventions. Here again, a very large piece, like in a group show where everybody had a little booth to show their work, and I decided to have something that's off the wall and encompassing from the lower floor to the ceiling of the building in a museum in Germany, in Wolfsburg. It's about 40 feet high and has different different radiuses, I guess you could say, that are actually cutting off the hole so that this becomes like a little zip going into the space and introducing the imaginative, illusionistic thinking that exists for me at the same time as the structured and named thinking. So I'm actually really working, as you have seen probably, very much in the field of the prelingual, where you do not name or use quotes or photographs or texts, because I'm very interested in the moment where the images start to emerge and have not yet found the definite form. These are actually predecessors. They are large ellipses that I started to make to understand, could the painting actually sit somewhere in the volume of the architecture instead of on a mass surface or on the walls themselves? And I was wondering, could they actually warp away from the Euclidean idea of three vectors making the space? And as you can see in this one, you have an elliptical form that is cut in with the original of the ellipse, which is a diversion of the circle. You look into the space, into white. You have a spared field of white, and at the same time, all these different conditions of missing form are coinciding in one situation. I made four of those and showed them in Kunsthalle Berlin, like a couple of years ago, trying to find out whether these different cut-in forms could actually, in the end, be a constitution of one painting where little things are missing in between. And then again, I would use one of those or some of those to put them outside and confront them with totally different contexts. So this one was shown for a little while in Düsseldorf against a 19th century church. And it was really also interesting to see that it totally changed the functional idea of the painting. Whereas here, very clearly, in a white cube space, in a very simple space that was nothing but a skin put up in Berlin, where they're now building the rebuilding the castle. So this box was up for like 2 years. If you would poke your hand through, you would be outside. So that was the minimum shelter for a painting. And then I was very intrigued to show this actually outside in relationship with an institution that was actually generating most of Europeans' painting for the last 2,000 years. I started to be very fascinated by the confrontation or the friction between the different areas of picture making or image making, and that there is this moment where my painting kind of passes over either objects or contours or borderlines, you would maybe call it. And I started to see that this moment, that two things go together, that they actually meet, the border or something like that little condensed space, is an invitation to look into it rather than understand it as a fencing off. And as you look into the area of the border, it opens up into a new space and kind of is an invitation to kind of compress maybe the informations that are coming from the two different areas. And so I started to be looking into this more, and at very moment I got an invitation by the Nasher in Dallas, which is a sculpture museum. A very, very beautiful collection is being shown there with a lot of different changes all over the year, and they started to invite people that are working on hybrid fields. So Martin Creed, for example, did a show there, or So I was invited to work on something especially for the space, and I was trying to compress exactly that area, that spatial hybrid in between different situations. And I came up with this very long, different, illogically cut line that is sitting in a multidimensional way on the floor of the building and also moves outside through the glass. Here you see it from in different situations. That's part, the second part of the show. The first part I just showed you, where people were actually stampeding the art piece after the first weekend. And here you see how the piece got mirrored in the glass and reflected on itself, and therefore kind of in a very magic way prolonged into the outside. In a very efficient way, of course, because I didn't have to build it. But this kind of understanding and turning around the inside or the outside or the field that is converging into very conflict-like moment of encounter, I also thought that has a lot to do with where your body ends and the outside begins. And sometimes I'm moving from these very abstract thoughts back into materials that are very, very essential to our understanding of who we are, like either through clothing that is marking the smallest skin invention we have until we touch our body, or like inflating and making larger what actually is just a balloon skin. So we see here a very small detail of a quite an expansive show I did in the De Pont in the Netherlands. I did that about 2 years ago. I would also experiment with other materials that are very iconic to our life, like the tree, for example, as much as I used the soil as such elementary conditions to our understanding of what nature might be. And I did this here inside, stacked up in a very small space. As you can see, it's crammed in, and it very much had a lot of associations and emotions contained, such as firewood, shelter, but at the same time, the blue I used was so cold and transformative that you could not quite tell what you were looking at. And this is what it looked like. What it looked like from the outside. It was a very small project space, but sometimes I use those spaces, to try things out, and that was the birth place of Kurt Tucholsky, a really interesting painter who lived in Berlin. And just a little moment later, I had the chance of trying these things. I did that alongside the project of the Metrotech Plaza. So you will see in a second why this is so interestingly converging. It was quite by chance, but this piece are three huge trees I found in a forest, and I did a wall piece for a show at the Hamburger Bahnhof in Berlin, and alongside a beautiful mirror piece of Pistoletto. You will see in a moment how that was connected. You can also see on the left-hand side there is a door. So there is a roller door that I shut, so the space was only to be accessed through two doors, and that roller door also had this notion of a garage door. So there was very much a notion of an outdoor space being painted and or being dealing with an indoor, very much an indoor practice. And here you see the Pistoletto, that were four mirrors, very small little broken mirrors. Four of them were sitting in the corners, and one was sitting in the center of the wall and sometimes reflecting a little detail of the piece. And now I'm coming to show you a little bit of the work in the Metrotech. As Andrea had said, it was like 18 pieces that we produced in Rhode Island, and that we cut and that got laminated and painted in the workshop in Rhode Island, and then they were transported to Brooklyn to this little forest-like structure with a very grid with a grid of trees. So the trees were very orderly put into that area, very beautiful. And I was really hoping to have the chance of having the trees pierce through the work. So there is actually like this kind of interference of the growing of the uncontrollable plant life and the work that is kind of giving open sometimes, yeah, different layers of things that would happen in between, and also people would of course walk in between. There was a lot of interaction of also the light, different weather conditions we had. You will see here, for example, with the snow. So the work was as if it was artificial, and also talking about a torn surface of an image, because all the other world would kind of shine through all the time. It was also changing quite a lot as much as it was artificial, and would be confronted with very strange and harsh conditions. Even in this photo, you might even wonder, what is now the artwork? Is it maybe the glacier in the front with the trees coming through? So, and also the community would react to it. So there was a lot of uncalculatable, unforeseen things happening, which were quite amazing to see. And it's still up. So if you like, you just take a train, it's not far. And this kind of interference, and also the not only the interference of people looking at it, but also of the people making it, have a lot to do with how the work develops. And this is maybe a really moment to say that I'm, of course, not doing this all alone. It's a lot of team effort involved. Not only, and I have to thank here, and I would like to thank here in this case Andrea and Nicholas, and also Sam and Micah, who have been so tremendously helpful, or Devra, who has been helping keep the work beautiful. It is the people who made the work, who come with their ideas. It's the people that are in my workshop at home. It's the people that organize my life. It's absolutely necessary to work together with people and to have a communal exchange to make the work happen. And a lot of the thoughts about the work are coming also from other people that resonate to the work. And one of these things that have developed past the 3 years is a project that I would like to show you now, a tiny little snippet of, which is in the making as we speak. It is a piece I'm doing in Philadelphia right now, and it's a huge wall painting group, I would even say, or agglomeration of wall paintings, which is along the corridor from Philadelphia Main Station outside the city, like 5 miles. The trains are not going as fast, and I've been invited to deal with this and develop this by the Mural Arts Program in Philadelphia, who has an amazing tradition of very narrative, figurative work. And they were having this thought of maybe inviting somebody who's doing something totally different. And they also invited Liz Thomas from Berkeley to curate that whole process and the show. And we've come up now with a process where 8 artists, some from my studio and 6 from Philadelphia, are working together hand in hand with like a certain amount of input from my side. You know, I gave a workshop, we were discussing the works, I was showing what I was intending to do in the different sites, and they kind of rethink and reinvent on the premises of this input. And here, this is quite a big painting. It's a warehouse. We are having 7 different sites alongside that corridor that all have very, very different aspects to them. There's a small hut. There's a large bridge. There's a lot of trees. There is a wall. There is like old. There are old leftovers, architectural, industrial debris. So it's going to be super fascinating. I will show you the warehouse, because that was the first thing that the team painted. It's quite huge, as you can see, and you will see it from the train, but you can also go in the city and see it. Some of the sites you can also see from bridges or from the other side of the street. Here you see something in its process. People have been painting it with white, and now they're painting it with magenta. I just went yesterday and had a look, and I was quite amazed to see what they were doing with what I was thinking they were doing, you know. And it's called Psyche Lustro, and it's gonna open on May 17th, and if you wanna come by, check out, it's muralarts.org. Thank you very much.
See if this is on. It is. Thank you, Katharina. That was such a great walk through the diversity of your practice over the last, was it how many years there? Maybe 10, 20? Maybe it was just 10. I think we should open the questions up to the audience, and please wait for a microphone so we can capture your voice for the video. But I wanted to just ask you a quick question to sort of get us started. I really enjoyed watching you work because I think there's a lot of, I think specifically for the kind of installation works you've been talking about, the idea of movement and how you physically move around the space is something that maybe is, maybe it's part of the spook you're talking about, but there's an energy there that comes through in the work. And you said something earlier about how, in terms of the relationship between the surface and the volume of painting, that there's sort of an interior and exterior, and it's a container, which you said yourself feels like a body. And I wonder if that also relates to the physical making of the work in some way for you. Is that clear?
Yeah,
I mean, it's a complicated question. Maybe.
Yeah, I don't know whether I got the question, but I would like to say something that maybe that relates to it. It's, I mean, I'm very aware that we are living in a world that has most of the times the homogeneous surface that communicates imagery to us. And I'm very much interested in the possibility of painting being exactly the reverse of that. And I'm interested in examining how that could actually have an impact on my understanding in the world. So I'm actually kind of rebuilding the photographic homogeneous surface into something that then breaks up into different areas again where I can have a very strong impact with my personality or my body or my understanding of as a being in this world. So I think that painting is such an elementary way coming from the body as the first kind of extension, right, that can inscribe into the world an opinion, a wish, a necessity, aggression, love, that is not being manipulated through certain, or maybe manipulated not in a negative sense, but it's not being, it's not running through a transmitter that makes it a certain imagery that's already homogenized and amalgamized. So therefore I think that the transfer from so-called bodily expression and thinking and activity, that is not a one step after the other step. I think it is all happening at the same time. And I'm, thinking and acting is happening at the same time. And I'm out there invisible as an individual that thinks and acts at the same time. So therefore, I think that is my answer. I mean.
Thank you. So we'll take some questions from the audience.
Thanks so much. I really enjoyed your talk. As an artist in New York, I'm kind of frustrated with how much the discourse here is about permanence and like protecting your value of your artwork as a commodity. So I was really interested to hear you talk about these projects that seem very much impermanent. And so I was wondering if you had any thoughts about how permanence or impermanence kind of adds like interest or temporal value or just visual, I don't know, how does it affect the work? Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, there is a lot of, as you say, there's a lot of work that is already disappeared. So a retrospective in my case would be really difficult. And also economically, that's an issue, of course. But I think there are so many different layers or levels of permanence and impermanence also, you know. I mean, we have no idea how long our so-called permanent works are going to be there. We're living in a world where we don't really have found a solution how to deal with our resources. I mean, we can't agree on all these things. So I don't know whether we are able to say what's going to last. Of course, with these things, also with, for example, psychilustro, very clearly is very temporary. And I've been, and the work lives on different levels also. I mean, it does live on in the people somehow who talk about it. It lives in film snippets, in the documentary photography, and also, I mean, I've been invited in a show, for example, that was called Studio Practice versus On-Site Work, for example. And there were people that were doing a lot of work, like Pavel Althammer, for example, who walks and then puts things together or has a lot of processes in his work. And I mean, the so-called open work that has been become like our convention of the last 20, 30 years does deal with the temporariness a lot. And I've been invited in that show, and that there was a really interesting question for myself: should I now put up a wall painting in that show, you know? How do I deal with things that are not visible anymore? And I had never thought about it because I'm so excited by making the work, actually not so much by looking at the work. And I came up with something. I've just realized I have it on here, like this piece, for example. The first spray piece to me is very important. I talked about it, I told you what I discovered there, and I thought, okay, if I'm now going to be in that show where we actually talk about impermanence and temporariness because we install on site, what then would I do? And I came up with the thought of making a big print on a silk curtain and actually install that work. I could also see it from the back, which I installed it in my studio so to try out what it would look like. And then I installed it, for example, in that show, which happened to have a wooden floor. And I put it on the ceiling with magnets, and I took it away from the wall like this far, so it was actually covering the wall on which it would normally sit, and it would just be a photograph, so it would not be the work, and it would cover the wall that would normally have the wall, so it's unclear what it actually is, and I think that's an interesting question. What does that photograph actually do? Because to somebody who hasn't seen the work, it's neither the work nor is it a photograph, yeah? So I'm thinking that could be also an interesting question. How do I deal with these receptions? How do I work with, it was fun for me to do it also. I discovered the fold in the work. So because it was a photograph that was then, because of its curtain quality, folded and had folds here, for example, all of a sudden I had like a new idea about the work and all the photos I look at. And also what you've seen here during this lecture, that's not the work, of course, you know. It's just some sort of agreement on, yeah, a structure you see. And yeah, I mean, there are many, I never think about permanence or non-permanence of it. I think there are qualities and quantities of time and size and space and velocity we pass by or we walk at it. They are all elements of it. I think if you agree on a certain understanding of permanence, which is you can wash it, you can transport it, or whatever it is, then you kind of maybe confine your practice to a certain sort of making, which is the well-madeness, a standard well-madeness. And that maybe is then hindering you to see it from the other side.
Katharina, thank you so much. I think one of the great pleasures of hearing you talk about the work is being able to see the trajectory and compare kind of the different stages of the work. And I remember actually also enjoying so much hearing you talk about the first spray-painted piece, thinking of the sort of complexity of the color and how that worked. And I remember sort of thinking when I began to see your work maybe in that style, it felt almost like in some ways to do with an erasure, and that you know, the kind of like, I mean, that piece is so much an architectural intervention, but also sort of changes the architecture, kind of erases the corner in a sense. It that green goes to black and you have that sort of invisibility. And then to think how your work, say, just two of us in Brooklyn, is so, you know, so flamboyant, so extravagant, so colorful, and that the form is of your invention as opposed to, you know, the existing architecture. And it just, it seems like a really fascinating, you know, kind of journey that you've gone on. It's not really a question, more an observation, but I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, the erasure, I think, is such an interesting observation. It is, I mean, why do you... it is, the erasure shows, or erasing something means you don't like it. Yeah, you want to do away with it. But then at the same time, it doesn't offer an alternative. And I'm very interested in the possibility to, with painting at least, I can do it, I think. I can erase and offer the alternative at the same time, which is maybe what you would call beauty or flamboyance or lushness, or maybe also it is a very, I think it is, I mean, this conflict of the, so a little bit like watercolory spray that is sitting on that, that is actually meeting that super resistant surface very often, whether it's made by myself or whether it's that nasty big warehouse or rubble or even maybe my personal belongings, they are actually resisting the image making. I mean, there's such a great saying by a painter who I totally love, but I can't remember his name now, Kokoschka. Kokoschka said, the most beautiful paintings I paint when I fall asleep. But then to actually make them, you know, there's resistance. There's this transition from like thought and imagination and wish into like that little moment where it starts to be made. And then the madeness or the materialization kind of does not agree with what we think. There is that kind of, and I think these two things meeting, the imagination or the thought process and the materialization process, they kind of contradict one another and create such a conflict, such a paradoxical conflict also, that I'm actually really looking at what is right there. And that's where erasure does not fully erase, and the materialistic or materialized surface does not fully hinder me. So therefore, my painting is not existent without these surfaces, and the surfaces are not in transition without my painting. So it's always the difference or the relationship of the differences that actually make the work. So therefore, of course, I kind of show my disagreement with whatever I hit with my image, my will to have an image, if you want. But at the same time, I try to implement my thoughts. Yeah.
Hi. I have a question. I was wondering if, do you ever see graffiti and kind of see a resemblance to your work? When I see your paintings, I kind of, reminds me of like exploring abandoned buildings and seeing how graffiti painters kind of overtake the space.
Yeah, I see graffiti, and I think it is very entertaining in our cities. Otherwise, it would sometimes be really sad, you know. I mean, but then there is a huge difference between the graffiti and my work. Graffitis are actually writings. And I don't think they take over space. I think they mark them with a name, and that name is actually confined to the contour of the information. But my work is totally doing the different. It's breaking different thing. It's breaking up the contour. It's actually expanding. It's not writing at all. You know, it's not confined to a certain area where the paint or the color is sitting inside, meaning a certain name or a certain, you know, a certain group of people that is saying this is ours. I'm not really saying this is mine when I'm painting on something. I really think that hierarchies can flip all the time, and I think with tagging that doesn't happen.
I have a question back here. Mm-hmm. Two of the examples you gave as analogies, the kokoschka as well as the spook, are these kind of semi-conscious or unconscious moments of production. Can you talk about the element of choice in terms of the colors that you use and the compositional decisions you make? Is it kind of, would you ascribe intention or what is the role of kind of randomness in that production, that making moment that you've described?
Yeah, I think there is no randomness at all. I'm working within a culture of art making that has conventions and understandings that I use and that I expand and that I work with and that I put together again and again. And there is an intention that is driving to certain decisions, and then these decisions create a new situation, and from there my intentions change. So that's the process. It is not that I have an idea and that's then getting executed by me or by others. So there is very clear intention everywhere, all the time, within the ever-changing situations I'm in with my work. And the colors I use them because they are strong, they are coming towards you like voice comes towards you. It's like the most direct way to draw attention to somebody. I think the use of color I have is very sexual. I want to kind of be in relationship with others without being an individual.
I have an interesting follow-up mm-hmm. question to that. That's mm-hmm. kind of a technical question. I was interested that you had said that when you were mixing the panel paintings that you were taking from your studio mm-hmm. and bringing them into an installation, mm-hmm. I noticed that in a couple of the situations that the background painting that you had matched up with the panel painting very much so. I mean, especially in the one that had the library. Mm-hmm. My question really was, then you're really tracing somehow a painting that exists from the studio and then hooking that up with something that you're doing in an installation then as well, so that it's kind of a trace of something that you did before that you're then following into this installation. Is that happening?
I didn't understand that the painting has traces of an installation that happened before?
No, the painting that you have has like a mark. Like if you had mm-hmm. a pink stripe then on the wall, then you're making a pink stripe to kind of, so that the back wall that you're installing this painting that you made in the studio.
Oh, no, I painted that over in the installation.
Okay.
So the painting was finished, was leaning against the wall, and then I painted the whole thing pink. From there to over there.
Okay, so that was what I wanted to know.
So you're
repainting the painting from that you brought from the studio mm-hmm. in the installation situation.
Yeah.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
thank you.
And sometimes I would take that painting again into another installation and then it would maybe partially get painted over as well. And again, it could happen. Sometimes I don't, sometimes I do. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. I'm curious about how you see the relationship in your work to landscape, both the tradition of landscape painting and to the actual landscape imagery.
I have roots in landscape painting. When I was very young, I did that. And I was very intrigued by the space that you encounter when you're outside, because it's like a 360-degree possibility you have all the time, and it does not end very fast. Whereas here, it kind of ends quite clearly with walls or things. And the indoor-outdoor situation, when I was very young, I was doing a lot of landscape painting, and I really hated to be inside. And I thought it was amazing to take your painting that you do outside, indoors, and then see what it was, out of the context, because when you're outside, you see everything with it. And the other thing that I really enjoyed doing when I was doing landscape painting, that I was actually looking at something, and I was looking at that little surface that I was painting on, and then I was looking again at something else, and then I was looking at the surface, and in between these movements of my eyes, I could not make sense. You know, so I realized that actually from the moment I look at something else and I look at the surface of the painting, something must happen, some sort of decision must happen, and then you do something. And I was very disturbed by that fraction of activities. So these were experiences I gathered doing that landscape painting, and that maybe has influenced my way of working, but that's not the only influence, you know. I lived in Italy and I encountered fresco painting and the relationship to architecture of these images, for example. Or I find a cave painting super interesting. I went to Australia and see rock painting, and I'm fascinated by Vermeer, how he uses the indoor and the light that comes through an imaginative window. I mean, there are all sorts of influences. It would be maybe a little too strict to put it into one situation and say, aha, that's how it comes about.
I think that's a great note to end on. Thank you, Katharina, for a great talk today. And please join me in thanking Katharina.